Welcome to All Things Financial with Jack Driscoll.
Welcome back again, everyone, to another edition of All Things Financial. As you know, if you've been following the show, we've been doing a series actually on business transition, business owners' transition, succession planning, whatever it's called today, is the process of transitioning from a business owner to maybe employee-owned business in the succession plan. And Dan Zugel, a respected guest who has been on the show helping us with this, is back again to summarize in this show what we've talked about. Dan, I'd like to welcome you back on the show.
Well, thanks for having me again, Jack. Appreciate it.
Dan, again, is a Senior Vice President of Business Transition Planning. And what we've talked about the last three segments, and you can go back through our resources and view basically what is business transition planning, what are the parameters and the factors and the issues that need considered, the considerations that lead us to when is a best suited time to consider an ESOP. And that's what Dan basically specializes in. So we came here today now to try to get into, all right, we know we want to do an ESOP or want to consider it further, but how do we do it and how do we finance this thing? And Dan, I'll turn it over to you to help out with that.
Yeah, thanks, Jack. Yes, we did go in considerable detail previously on, you know, ESOPs, the tax advantages, the advantages to the community, the selling shareholder, the employees, the company. We talked about why the government, both federal and state, really like ESOPs, how it eases the burden on the government safety nets. We talked about control, that the control does not leave necessarily the selling shareholder and the board of directors. We talked about the seller gets fair market value for the stock as negotiated on an arm's length transaction. So there's a lot of positives to an ESOP, and the tax breaks particularly, as well as the non-tax advantages of ESOPs, are quite significant, especially to smaller communities in which they rely on that employer. An ESOP keeps that intact and keeps the fabric of that community rock solid. But then it comes to the time of, well, how do we finance an ESOP? Because you remember, one of the tax advantages of an ESOP, one was not paying the capital gains tax on the sale. The second was the corporate income tax deduction on the entire sales price. The third was, and this is the big one, the company, the profits of the company are no longer subject to federal or state income tax. And then we had the discussion, sounds too good to be true. We talked about how that actually happens. And in summary, here's how that works. The ESOP now owns the stock. You may recall an ESOP is a qualified defined contribution retirement plan, like a 401k, like a pension plan, like a profit sharing plan, covered under the same code section of the IRS in the Department of Labor. So therefore, an ESOP being a qualified retirement plan does not pay income tax. So if the ESOP owns all the shares of the company, and it's an S corporation ESOP, and S corp's a flow through entity, so the tax burden on an S corporation flows through to the owner of the stock. If the owner of the stock in our scenario is an S corporation ESOP, no taxes are paid because the ESOP is tax exempt. So now we've increased the cash flow of the company 35% to 40% of what it was prior to the ESOP. So what we have is a lot of tax savings that can be used to pay off the debt we have incurred to buy potentially 100% of the stock from the selling shareholder. And remember, the selling shareholder can still be chair of the board and remain, get salary perks and benefits and still be there. And we found all the cash flow we need to pay off the debt. But then comes the rub. And in every scenario we've had so far, we've just said, well, the bank will lend us money. Well, in real life, the bank is not going to lend 100% of the sale price of any business. You know, a senior lender was not going to lend all of the sale price of a business, 100%. They're just not going to do it. We've talked to them, we tried to get them to do it, and just no bank's going to do it, especially today. So we have the cash flow, but we don't have the financing to give to the seller. So what do we do? And this is kind of what's really been the hot spot and the hot button in the ESOP community over the last 5, 6, 7 years. And so now I think all the providers kind of come to an agreement, as well as the Department of Labor and the IRS, have all come to the conclusion that a combination financing plan may make the best sense, and everybody's okay with it down the line. Mm-hmm. And so here's what happens. Generally, we'll take what the bank will lend us. You have any senior lender that's willing to lend for ESOP purposes. It's slightly different nuances, but there are plenty of banks out there that are more than willing to lend for ESOP purposes. But even the most willing lender is not going to lend 100%. They may lend generally 2 times the company's earnings or 2 times the company's EBITDA, earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization, generally about 2 times that number, maybe 2.5, and in some rare examples, 3 times that number, which gets us to around 40 or 50% of the total sales price. So the bank will lend the ESOP, and then the ESOP uses that to give to the seller. So the seller gets about half the money, 40%, 50% upfront, less any existing corporate debt. So therefore, what do we do with the balance? Well, we have the cash flow to pay back a loan even for the 100%, but the bank will only give us 50%. What do we do? Well, there are several potential solutions to that. One is we could go out to the secondary market. There are lenders out there that would be happy to sit behind the bank in a subordinate position, maybe even interest only, to the bank for a period of time, and they're willing to lend that differential, that 50 or 60% that the bank would not lend. However, they're not going to lend that money at senior bank rates, are they, Jack?
No.
They're not charging 4, 5% as the senior lenders are, who are nice, safe, and secure at first position. Sitting behind those folks, interest only, they're going to want a rate in today's environment maybe 10 to 12%. So if you wanted to finance 100% of the ESOP transaction, you could in fact find somebody that would do it most likely. However, we say there might be a better way. We say, of course, take what the bank will lend you. It's generally, frankly, cheap money, today's interest rate environment. So we'll take what the bank offers us. But in lieu of going to the secondary markets, such as mezzanine and private equity, that would lend that amount above what the bank would lend, we say to the seller, why don't you take that portion? Take back a seller note instead. So you get what the bank will lend you as a down payment, but then the seller will take over a period of years, maybe 8 years, maybe 10 years, 12 years, 15 years, however the math works, the seller will just receive the balance in equal installments over a period of years. Now, if we were sitting here 5 years ago, Jack, and we were having the same conversation, I would say to the seller, hey, you did it to facilitate the transaction. You're getting your money a good portion up front. You're getting the rest over time. You deserve a market rate of interest on the part that you're taking over time. And so market rate of interest, we would look at the bank and say the bank's charging 4.5%. or whatever they're charging, and say, seller, that is market rate of interest as determined by the bank. Well, the wisdom, that's old conventional wisdom, but current ESOP thought, and once again, this is kind of what's changed in the ESOP community in the last few years, last 5 or 6 years, everybody's realized, including the Department of Labor, the IRS, all the attorneys and accountants and ESOP providers like myself, have realized that that is not market rate of interest. Our previous exercise of who is willing to lend and sit behind the bank on a subordinate basis, what those folks charge is truly what market rate of interest is. So old school thought was, hey, the bank's charging 4.5, seller, you get 4.5 on the part that you're taking over time. But that's not true anymore. What's true now is what should have always been true is if the seller is sitting behind the bank, taking interest only for the duration of the bank loan and subordinate to the bank, that seller is entitled to that same market rate of interest as those mezzanine next level lenders would have charged to sit in that same position.
That makes sense.
So therefore, the seller's entitled to a total return of 10 to 12% if that happens to be what the current market rate is for that kind type of a lender. So the seller can instantly get a very nice rate of return for bearing that seller debt.
A lot.
And so that's nice. We could just stop there, but there's a couple problems with that. The first problem is The banks generally do not want anybody earning more interest than they're earning. And it's true. When negotiating the financial package, everything is disclosed, and the bank will generally say, I'm really not comfortable with that interest of 10-12% in my example going out the door to somebody else. That's a drain and a strain on the corporate cash flow that's going to inhibit and hurt maybe the ability of the company to pay back our loan. And so therefore, we prefer a lower rate of interest. But I think more importantly is the interest portion that the seller is getting. That is taxable as ordinary income,
right?
Because that's interest earned. Whereas, if you remember previous conversations, the underlying principal portion of the sale price could be tax-free,
right?
Capital gains tax-free, and we've talked about that a lot. So therefore, the seller, we say to the seller, instead of taking 12% interest, why don't you take the 4 or 5 that the bank is taking?
Okay.
But in lieu of that, because you gave up something, you gave up a lot of interest, we say to the seller, why don't you take a future equity stake in the company
in
addition to the 100% sales price you're already getting. So they can get currently up to 25 or 30% of the future value of the company as a reward for taking subordinate notes at less than market interest rate in addition to the underlying principal that may be tax-free. And that future equity interest is of a tax-free company, Jack.
Mm-hmm.
That upside's unlimited. And then when the seller note is paid off and when the bank note is paid off, then that future equity stake, usually in the form of warrants, becomes payable again to the selling shareholder at whatever they grow that business to. A $10 million business may grow to $20 million.
Yes.
Then the seller gets 25 or 30% of that number. And by the way, we've also changed the tax nature because that future equity stake is taxed as capital gains tax, right, not taxed as ordinary income as the interest would have been taxed. So therefore, that future equity stake is not worth much money at the day you get it, right? Because we just leveraged this company 100%. The stock value, especially 30% of the future stock value in today's valuation, is not worth anything.
Right.
This leads me to what we have not covered yet, but I've teased, is the fourth major tax advantage of ESOPs. At the time these future equity stake of the company, the time this is granted, the stock's not worth much.
Okay.
At all, hardly anything at all. So therefore, that's the great time to do your state tax gifting. You gift this future equity stake that we know is going to go up when the loans are repaid later. When the equity value goes back up, these future equity stakes are going to be worth a lot more money. Now's the time to gift those into family limited partnerships. And if done properly with the proper estate planning techniques, it could be with zero or no or little gift and estate tax consequence today. It's tremendous. So that wraps up the financing portion of ESOP that kind of ties it all together from everything we've done so far, Jack. And that's kind of the current state of ESOPs is the financing, seller combination seller, bank financing with that future equity stake, and that's what's getting ESOP deals done today.
I can see why they're getting more popular, and I'm thankful that the government's helping to promote them.
I agree.
Mm-hmm. What do we do from there when we deal with, we've got the financing in place now, how do we put this all together?
Well, generally you'd see somebody that does ESOP consulting work, and shamelessly, that's me.
There we go.
You know, you need somebody that can put all this together, quite frankly. And any ESOP provider, there's some of us out there, a bunch of us out there nationally. You know, somebody has to do a lot of cash flow analysis. That's key.
Okay.
Location is the real estate, cash flow is to an ESOP.
Okay.
Now, you can see how we've increased cash flow by not paying income tax anymore.
Right.
But we still have to be cognizant of up and down years of the company. Can they cash flow this commitment? And how do we have to structure the notes? Do we have the employee base that we need? We have to kind of look at all these things. And that's what an ESOP consultant will do. They'll figure this out, arrange the bank financing, structure the seller notes, make sure that everything's working properly, hiring all the valuation firms, hiring the record keepers, hiring all the people that need to be hired, and make sure things are done properly. So that's pretty important to the process.
So it manages all of these components that you're talking about with a specialist, like a coach, really to coach through all the different changes.
Yeah, that's exactly it.
Yeah.
This is a major deal. We're selling the stock of a company. Mm-hmm. The seller's baby that they may have grown from infancy 40
right.
years ago.
Right.
So, I mean, due diligence has to be done. We have to make sure the bylaws and everything about the company, stock splits might need to be done. Mm-hmm. You know, consolidating business entities into a new holding company. There's a lot of things that need to be addressed, and like anything, the devil's in the details. But with a good attorney, a good consultant, and good accountant, we can manage these things and package them up into a bite-sized, chewable pieces right. and get the transaction done right on time and on money.
And I can see how this is geared toward perpetuating the company and helping turn over the reins to the company having its own life without being so dependent on the original owner in that case, which is one of the goals of the book of the E-Myth. Are you working just at a company job, or are you building a business that will survive long right. after you're gone?
That's right, and it's a heck of an incentive to that key management of the company. When the seller says, look, I know you've been chomping at the bit to run this company, and I know you're going to try to come up and try to buy me, but we both know you don't have enough money to buy me.
Yes.
Here's a good solution. When I'm paid out, when my seller notes and my warrants and the bank notes are paid off, mm-hmm. I agree to resign. Mm-hmm. I'm out. You're now president, CEO, in charge of this company and chair of the board. You right. run the company. Right. And guess what? You didn't have to outlay one nickel out of your own pocket. You did not have to second mortgage your house. And knowing when I'm out, so work hard.
Yes.
Buy me out. Pay me out as fast as you can. We're all for that.
Yeah.
Then you're in charge of this company with no out-of-pocket costs. And so the key managers really like it. The CFO, the new president. So they're incentivized to work hard, as well as the rank and file. I mean, who's working harder than an employee that whose retirement benefits are dependent upon the value of the stock growing at this company? And a lot of people, and I like to use the phrase, just to illustrate this point, do you wash a rental car? No, you own a piece of this. You own that car. Your first car. Remember your first car?
Yes.
That 33 Chevy or whatever that was. You know, you're scrubbing that thing up every day.
Yeah.
Well, same thing with employees that own that are beneficial owners in an ESOP. Right. They are working hard. They're saying, "Hey, if we move this table closer to this table, I can save 10 minutes a day, and that increased profitability. We lower workers' comp premiums. That increases the value."
Right.
Of the company. We can yeah. even demonstrate certain things of how you increase value. In fact, in almost every ESOP we do, when we roll the meeting out, we do a rollout meeting to the employees and say, great news, your owner could have sold to anybody.
Yes.
And maybe made more money. Generally not, but maybe, you know, could have made more to a strategic buyer. But they decided to sell to you to make sure and ensure jobs stay in this town and that you stay employed.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen grown men cry because of this.
I believe
But it is absolutely remarkable. And so we can show them ways of just increasing their job. I did a poultry company one time that takes Tyson's leftover chicken carcasses. Mm. It's gross, but it's true.
Yeah.
And they took those carcasses and took out any remaining edible meat for the proteins of pet food.
Okay.
And we found that if they stick their finger in one more time, get a little more protein out, they'd increase the value of the company by $1 million a year.
Wow.
By just getting 1% more meat out of this carcass, just carrying a little bit more,
really?
Increased the value of the company. There was 80 employees.
And
so they were doing the math.
Them through that analysis.
Oh, yes, absolutely. We did the ESOP and did it simple examples such as that if you do 1% more meat out of that carcass, you grow the company by $1 million and there's 80 employees. You all split that. I can see the mental math going through people's heads.
Wow.
And that's the thing that happens all over the place in ESOPs. And that's why ESOP companies statistically, since the history of ESOPs, since ESOPs began, ESOP companies outperform their peers dramatically in every study across the board. So that helps the owner with the future equity stake.
Mm-hmm.
That helps the employees. And that helps, frankly, senior management who often have some synthetic stock. It's a different conversation, yeah. but they often have also an incentive to keep the stock price going. So when everybody's pushing the same direction and growing value, and part of growing value is growing this business, that's hiring more employees. That's adding another building. That's adding a new product line, adding new sales managers. You're adding people and profitable ways of growing this business. And that's why a lot of our politicians like this.
You know, it's interesting because what you're saying is what we all know, but everybody's doing what they're doing in life, employees and employers alike, and everybody in the government and everyone else, for what's best in their best interest. Zig Ziglar said, all of us listen to the same radio station, WIIFM. What's in it for me? And that's where you're dealing with in investing the employees in your chicken company,
right,
actually, with just that small benefit. Whereas if you said that benefits the employer and that employer gets all the profit from your additional efforts, that might just bounce off and not have any effect. But in an ESOP plan, that's money's in their pocket. That's dollars in their own pocket.
And they get a statement every single year saying, here's how many shares I have, here's how many more shares I got, here's how vested I am. Yeah. So the employees are pushing one direction. The key managers are trying to be profitable so they can get the old man out.
Right.
And then the seller, because they sold 100% of the company, got fair market value in our $10 million company, they got $4 million up front, $6 million over time.
Right.
And then maybe another $4 million in that future equity stake.
Right. And who's so is it now? Everybody.
That's right.
Everybody.
Everybody's pushing the exact same direction. That's exactly right.
Well, I sure appreciate it, Dan. I appreciate your coming on the show, sharing this information with a lot of us who are unaware this strategy and tool even really existed, which might be the perfect fit for some of these people. So again, just tell us briefly, I know we're almost out of time, who the correct candidate is to then take this discussion one step further.
Yeah, from the financial standpoint, it starts working with a company that has about $1 million of net earnings or EBITDA. About $1 million that equates to about a $5 million value, which is what we're looking for, about 20 or more employees and about $1 million of payroll. And a company that's successful.
Okay.
You know, you need a successful company that has good management and an owner that cares about his community and his employees, that wants some tax advantages in a way of transferring a business.
So anyone who's watching and listening to the show who wants more information to take this discussion to the next level, give Dan a call or contact him. We'll show you how at the end of the show. Dan, again, I thank you very much for coming on the show to do this series.
Thank you for having me. It was an absolute pleasure.
Thanks again, everyone, for tuning in to another edition of All Things Financial. We'll be back again next week. Dan, if anybody wants to get a hold of you, what's the best way for them to do that?
Well, the best way to get a hold of me is by phone at 724-766-3998. That's 724-766-3998. Or dzugell, dzugell at bta.us.com, or visit my website at esopguy.com.
Very good. Thanks, Dan.
Thank you.
You've been listening to All Things Financial with your friend with the answers to all financial matters, Jack Driscoll of Driscoll Insurance and Financial Services. Securities and investment advisory services offered through Sage Point Financial Incorporated, a registered broker-dealer and registered investment advisor and member FINRA and SIPC. Driscoll Insurance and Financial Services is not affiliated with Sage Point Financial, Inc. or registered as a broker-dealer or investment advisor. You can reach Driscoll Insurance and Financial Services Incorporated at 412-833-1500, and they are located at 2738 South Park Road, Bethel Park, Pennsylvania, 15102.